A warm welcome to all of you to this launch ceremony of this book, Manthan, Art and Science of Developing Leaders. I am Dr. Manushi Chaudhary, Associate Professor with BIMTEC, and I am the anchor for this evening. Before we proceed, I have a small request to make. Kindly put your cell phones on to silent mode. Thank you. We shall begin today's proceedings by lighting the ceremonial lamp and invoking divine blessings. I request our chief guest, Padma Bhushan Dr. M.B. Athreya, and our guests of honor, Mr. R.B. Shahi, Padma Shri Dr. Pritam Singh, and Mr. Kamal Singh, together with Dr. Chaturvedi, to please do the honors.
इसका भी एक रूल है
Sir, he said from the other side, sorry.
Ajay, aao bhai, hum dono bhi saath mein aao. Aao bana. Diya to jalega.
Bilkul.
Years of experience in teaching, research and administration. As a former director with the All India Council for Technical Education, he has been associated with the formulation of policies, planning, regulation and control of management education. So may I please invite you on stage. Mr. Kamal Singh, Executive Director and CEO, Asia Pacific, UN Global Compact Network, is an alumnus of JNU. Earlier, he was the Director General at National HRD Network, wherein he contributed a lot and has been awarded many a times for his outstanding performance and initiatives. He is on the board of several organizations and institutions, including BIMTEC. Our guest of honor, Mr. Gurdeep Singh, CMD, NTPC, is likely to join us a little later. He is a mechanical engineer who started his career with NTPC and has worked at various levels both in Indian and multinational companies. Earlier, he was managing director of Gujarat State Electricity Corporation Limited. Padma Shri Dr. Pritam Singh, Chairman Lead Center, is one of the global gurus in the area of leadership. He is a Midas Touch leader, having the distinction of giving direction to IIM Lucknow, ASCII, IIM Bangalore and MTI Gurgaon. He has worked on the boards of more than 100 companies and academic institutions. He has authored 7 books, of which 3 are award-winning. The Government of India acknowledged his contribution in 2003 by conferring on him the prestigious Padma Shri. Mr. R.B. Shahi, Chairman, Energy Infratech Private Limited, held the position of Secretary to the Government of India, Ministry of Power, from 2002 to 2007. In this position, he was responsible for policy initiatives and implementation for the entire power sector in India. During his tenure, the Indian power sector went through a major restructuring with the institution of the Electricity Act 2003 and subsequent National Electricity Policy 2005. Electricity Tariff Policy 2006, and many more. It is an honor to have you on stage here today, sir. Our chief guest today, Padma Bhushan Dr. Mrityunjay Athreya, has been a founder and pioneer in Indian management education. He joined the faculty of IIM Kolkata as early as 1967. The IIM Kolkata, along with IIM Ahmedabad, was one of the first 2 institutes of management set up by the Government of India way back in 1962. He was one of the outstanding members of the IIM faculty, much sought after by public and private enterprises as a trainer and consultant. Since 1967, over the last 5 decades, he has advised enterprises in several sectors such as oil and gas, power, fertilizers, steel, automobiles, banking, insurance, IT, health, etc. Dr. Athreya has served on many government policy committees. The best known is the 1991 Athreya Committee on Indian Telecom Restructuring. A proud recipient of many awards, he was honored with the Padma Bhushan Award by the Government of India in 2014. Sir, may we please have you on stage. A few words on the genesis of this book. Over the years, academicians and researchers have proposed various models of leadership. Some suggested the need of value and ethics-based leadership on creative aspects of individual personality. Some researchers also presented leadership development as a systematic and planned methodology using behavioral and scientific tools. BIMTech, together with National HRD Network and Aon Hewitt, took the initiative to organize roundtables under the theme The Art and Science of Developing Leaders to bring various stakeholders on a common ground, to collate their experiences, to share processes, to look at best practices, and to predict the future roadmap for leadership development in India. A diverse set of 55 leaders deliberated on 12 panels on different sub-themes related to leadership in metros like Delhi, Mumbai, Pune, Bangalore, Hyderabad, Chennai, Kolkata, and Bhubaneswar, bringing in clarity and a holistic outlook to this topic. Their views and opinions have been organized in this book under the various sub-themes of respective roundtables. Through these compilations, the editors offer current and future thinking of India that may trigger a proper, innovative, and exciting process of developing leaders, particularly for business. To continue with the proceedings, may I now invite Dr. Chaturvedi to deliver the welcome note.
Thank you, Dr. Mansi. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great pleasure that in this book launch ceremony of Manthan Art and Science of Developing Leaders, we have amidst us some of very senior management gurus and thought leaders from the industry. On behalf of BIMTech, I have great pleasure in welcoming the chief guest for the occasion, the renowned management advisor, Padma Bhushan, Dr. Mrityunjay Athreya. And our guest of honor, Mr. R.G. Sahi, Chairman, Energy Infratech Private Limited, Padma Shri, Dr. Pritam Singh, Chairman, Lead Center, Mr. Gurdeep Singh, Chairman and Managing Director of NTPC, who is likely to join, and Mr. Kamal Singh, Executive Director and CEO, Asia Pacific United Nations Global Compact Network. I request you to welcome them once again with a big applause. Padma Bhushan, Dr. Mrityunjay Athreya is an icon of management to several generations of Indian managers, management teachers, trainers, consultants, and students. He returned from the US in 1967 with a doctorate in business administration from the Harvard Business School. Before Harvard, he also studied at the Stanford Business School, California. Thus, he had the benefit of the two best management schools in the US, which he immediately brought to India. Dr. Athreya has served on many government policy committees. Many companies like ITC, Unilever, IOC, ONGC, BHEL, SAIL, HMT, etc. embarked on strategic planning, organizational development, and HRD with Dr. Athreya's help. Sir, we are delighted to have you with us today. As former Secretary of the Ministry of Power, Government of India, Mr. R.G. Sahi was responsible for policy initiatives and implementation for the entire power sector in India. He is a member on the board of many companies and committees. Earlier, he was CMD of BSES Limited and Director of Operations NTPC. He has authored 4 books on energy and power sectors and has been honored with many awards. We are very fortunate to have Mr. Sahi with us on this occasion. Thank you, sir, for joining today. Our chief mentor, guide, and philosopher for our institute, Padma Sri, Dr. Pritam Singh, is a profound thinker with great mastery at integrating thought with action. He is an outstanding scholar leader, combining both the wisdom of architecting strategies as well as executing them in an excellent manner. He is a great humanist, loved and respected as a friend, philosopher, and guide. We are indeed blessed to have him amidst us here today. Thank you, Dr. Singh. We are really grateful. Mr. Gurdeep Singh, who is awaited and who is likely to join, has nearly 3 decades of experience in power generation sector. And as far as I know that he has been considered as a game-changing leader in the power sector of state of Gujarat. And the government of India has given this responsibility to him with the expectation that he will replicate the same magic with the whole country. He has worked in different areas of power sector ranging from business development, projects and operations. It is our pleasure that he will be with us today. Mr. Kamal Singh is a friend of BIMTEC. Mr. Kamal Singh likes to contribute beyond business towards building human capital index of India and the world. Prior to joining United Nations Global Compact Network, he was the Director General of very important professional body in HR profession, that is National HRD Network. In that capacity, he partnered with BIMTEC for all the HR roundtables that we organized, and I know that out of 23 roundtables organized so far by BIMTEC in partnership with National HRD Network and Ion Hewitt and Deloitte, probably most of them were attended by him as an organizer. I am very pleased that he is with us on this occasion. Thank you, Mr. Singh. I also extend a hearty welcome to all the guests and stalwarts of the industry assembled here. I am surprised that what kind of great goodwill authors have that the program, before the starting of the program, there is no space left and some more people are likely to join. So I will request my colleagues from BIMTEC that they should spare their chairs for our guests, honored guests, because there is so much emotional warmth for the authors. So I congratulate our authors also, Professor Sinha and Professor Mr. Soni, and the third author, Mr. Hindadil Mitra, who is currently working with NTPC. All of us are aware about the spiritual leadership development activities in India in the recent years. There have been dramatic efforts in Indian as well as in foreign companies to quickly develop leadership skills at all levels in an organization. The reason of this recent spurt lies in the current growth trajectory of Indian companies. Many Indian companies are growing at mind-boggling growth rates. Companies which grew at 3 to 4% per annum in the first 30 years of their establishment increased tenfold or more since the advent of the new millennium. This has put tremendous pressure on companies to develop leadership at all levels in the shortest possible time. The workplace of the 21st century is characterized by great complexities, uncertainties, ambiguities, and interconnectedness. Unprecedented and discontinuous growth brings to the fore both opportunities and challenges. The purpose of organizing HR Roundtable, as Dr. Mansi Chaudhary explained, under the theme of the art and science of developing leaders, was to bring the company's consultants, academic institutions, and leadership coaches and trainers on a common ground to collect their experiences, to share processes, to look at best practices, and to predict the future roadmap for leadership development in India during the coming decades. It's a matter of great pleasure for me to witness the launch of this publication, which includes various perspectives of eminent professionals on these issues. Thank you.
Honorable Chief Guest, for this evening, Padma Bhushan Dr. M.B. Atria, Padma Sri Dr. Pritam Singh, Mr. R.B. Sahi, Dr. Chaturvedi, the authors, Professor K.K. Sinha, Mr. Indranil Mitra, Mr. Soni, distinguished member of the audience, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. It is truly an honor to be here, to be part of this august gathering. I must say, when we discussed this idea of putting this such intellectual capital assimilated over these 23 round tables, we never imagined that we would get such a huge response from various quarters. Therefore, the first credit for bringing this effort must go to the Sutradhar, the authors, Professor Sinha, Mr. Indranil Mitra, and Mr. Soni, who could tirelessly work on this project, and it was not easy. So I must congratulate them for making these efforts. Actually, if I look back, the organization like ours, we do bring so much thought leadership in terms of discussing, brainstorming, deliberating, but only few times we are able to put it together, which can be used for many occasions as a reference or for future managers to really comprehend and learn from there. So this effort, to me personally, was something gratifying that it is today coming in a book form. And to that extent, if whatever the efforts we will see as Manthan, it is truly a subject that they have brought, which is most Google. And there have been several books and articles, material on the subject of leadership, as you know. I'm not going to talk on all that because you will have ample opportunity to understand from the book itself that how much it is so much valued today. And in one sentence, if I have to say that what is today the biggest challenge globally to manage our corporation, businesses, or society, or even families, to me it is leadership. So therefore, the book is contemporary. And it is particularly contemporary that it is coming out with so much authors who are practitioners and also thought leaders in their own right. And I must say that they have also taken this subject, the leadership is a subject of both art and science. And having gone through the book, I can say with a lot of conviction that truly it is both. And to that extent, it is really a trailblazing initiative or even path-breaking. And I was just sharing with you that when we were talking about, we were able to gather a lot of very valuable opinions, ideas, which we felt should be shared with a wider audience. In addition, we also wanted to express our own thoughts on the subject, which author have done it very nicely. And we evolved a somewhat a diamond model of leadership and a 3D model of the interesting qualities which we felt a leader should possess. The diamond model is very versatile and possesses a sufficient flexibility for adoption in different business environment and different geographies. Taken together, we feel that these two will serve as a framework or reference and a guide for those who are tasked with the job of leadership development in many organizations. Why do we call it art as well as science? There are certain fixed principles which should be followed by those who develop leaders. Depth, discipline, and dynamism in our 3D model are qualities we feel have to be inculcated by every leader. If he or she is to be successful, these principles are immutable and have the force of natural laws. In this sense, we say leadership development is a science. Similarly, the concept of crucible roles for developing leaders is a principle which needs to be followed. It is an art because each organization's specific task of developing leaders is dependent on the circumstances in which the organization finds itself, its business environment, its competition, its geographical location, the nature of its workforce, its leadership, and so on. Therefore, every task can be different and has to be tailored to the situation and the unique needs of the particular organization. This calls for adopting our strategy for leadership development to the requirements. There cannot be no one-size-fits-all approach, such as adaptation or modifications calls for not. And if you look at one way, then you would have also find that rarely there is one person or one organization always successful. And there is, so therefore, if one person is always successful, maybe in one corporation, maybe five corporation, if he's changing his job, but the person may not always be assured of that is successful in one geography or may not succeed in another geography. To that extent, the diamond model evolved by us is sufficiently flexible to allow for this kind of variability. At the same time, it is also holistic, giving an integrated picture of how the job can be managed. And some of you would have seen this book or read it, I think in the first section of the book, Leadership in India Way is especially significant because we believe that the route followed in India was quite different from that taken in the West. We have attempted to trace this route from ancient time to the pre- and post-independence era up to the present day in this section. Since Vedic times, Indian leaders, the king and princes, were imbued with the spirit of giving back to the community and society and running up their kingdoms in accordance with the dharma or ethical code of behavior. Even in Indian system, you would find many of the corporations, even now, do have this philosophy. They learned their principles in the gurukuls of yore, where royal families used to send their princesses at an early age to absorb wisdom at the feet of the guru. We believe that the best and brightest of Indian business leadership have absorbed and assimilated these principles because they are part of our cultural ethos, and they live and breathe them in their daily activities, paying heed not only to the profit motive, but to the corporate social responsibility and ethical behavior, building not only their businesses, but helping to build Indian society and the nation. And we have tried to reflect this truth in this book. Of course, there is much more to be learned from the West as also, and subsequent sections of this book are devoted to this, building global leaders, leaders as change agents, and role of leadership in encouraging diversity and promoting innovation. And I'm sure that as you will go along this manthan, I'm sure this will serve as a very good guide for leadership development, both in Indian context and globally. Before I conclude, let me say that it was truly, again, an honor and privilege to have associated with this journey. And under the aegis of BIMTEC, the effort that we put together of conducting these roundtables across India and with different leaders from different organizations, from different institutions, including best of the admired IIMs and IITs, professors also were invited in various sessions. The credit for this ultimately also goes to the institution like BIMTEC, who has thought of and supported, I thought of supporting this cause. And this particular effort must be complemented as we move on, and therefore, a big hand to all of you, please. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity, and I really appreciate it.
May I now request Mr. Adi Shani to please deliver his address.
Respected Dr. Atreya, respected Dr. Pritam Singh, Dr. Chaturvedi, Kamal Singh Ji, the authors of the book, Mr. Sinha, Mr. Rajay Soni, Mr. Indrani or Indranil Mitra, the distinguished invitees, also the spouses of the authors who will be receiving the book when it is released. They have a great role to play in sparing you people to work so hard. I must say that Dr. Chaturvedi was saying that even before the function started, the hall is packed and the more guests are likely to come. What is the trick and what is the secret? I remember in this very hall, we had another book release of Mr. K. Krishna,
yes,
about 2 years.
Yes, sir.
2 years back. And I also had the privilege of being part of that event. And Dr. Pritam Singh was also there. But Dr. Pritam Singh, if I remember, you stressed many points. And each time we listen to you, we have something extra that added to the wealth of knowledge that anybody acquires. And that time you said that one of the good qualities of a leader is connectedness, networking and connectedness. So when Dr. Chaturvedi mentioned that what is the secret of so many people responding to the book launch of the authors led by K.K. Sinha, then I clearly imagined and remembered the sentence that you said at that time, connectedness and networking. So I think he has such a good network of people supporting him, identifying his ideas, making him feel good, participating in anything that he does, and therefore that explains the, all the impact before the function started. Of course, Dr. Atreya and all of you on this dais and many people off the dais, I had the privilege of in some way or the other working with you. I remember when we were in deep trouble in turning out around the Badarpur power station, way back in 79, 80, around that time. So we evolved a different type of training program, not a training program which begins with inauguration and ends with valedictory, but a series of training programs whereby people identify the issues, they draw an action plan, put managerial input into the whole thing, and then also see how these things are moved. So it was a training program versus learning versus review versus monitoring. That means capacity building of the people to deliver. And that was a great association, I remember, with Dr. Atreya. After that, I think we had another occasion when Dr. Atreya was requested to work for the reorganization or regionalization of NTPC. Mr. K.K. Sinha ensured that it never happens. That is in the lighter way. He was all for it, but there were other forces. So, in that assignment again, I had the occasion to be very closely associated with Dr. Atreya. So, it has always been a pleasure, on assignment, off assignment, to be associated with him. Of course, Dr. Pritam Singh again for many years, I think decades. It could be some from 1980 to now we are almost 37 years, it has always been. So you have a, and Kamal, I tell you frankly, I didn't know much about this book, how it was made, which is only from your brief description, how this book emerged, with 23 round tables that I have learned only now. He was nice to send me a manuscript type, not the printed one, but then I had not read. I only read Dr. Atreya's foreword and a little bit of your mantan, Samudra mantan, and beyond that I couldn't go. So I think it is a great pleasure and honor to be here in release and launch of the book. Of course, release and launch of this book of one of the very, very, very eminent colleagues. We had association of working. K.K. Sinha himself, I think, before it, he used to work for coal washing, yeah, and coal washing was part of Steel Authority. And I was in the headquarters of Steel Authority. This is the story of something like 68, 69.
70, yeah.
Something like that. Yeah. Personal officer in, or something, yeah, senior personal officer in coal washing in Dhanbad. And I used to go to Dhanbad for various activities because coal washing was under the control of.
I'm glad you remember it still.
Hindustan Steel then, and then later on Steel Authority. So I think our association has been so deep and so rich of mutual learning that it is always a pleasure to be associated with such wonderful work that a colleague of yours does, which is a claim by, his earlier book was also a claim by most of the people who have occasion to read the book. So far as I am concerned, the first time that I heard this term, leadership, was in 1970 when I was doing MBA in the Naval Institute in Ranchi. Leadership. It was not in engineering course, not in science course, but in the management course, 3-year evening course, and very tough. That was the first time leadership, style of leadership, autocratic leader, democratic leader, less friendly, and since then, of course, that has been seed of understanding leadership, seed, which the first term where I might have heard Newton's law, I might have heard of thermodynamics, but not leadership and leadership style before 1970. 70 was the first time that I got that. Ever since, I think over the years, the understanding of this subject, I don't know whether I have become better in understanding or not better in understanding, but time has given an opportunity to learn and to be confronted with this concept again and again, again and again. I think we also, when I did management, then one term that I learned, which I believe it is true, universality principle of management. Whether you are working in a hospital, you are working in a college, you are working in a political party, or you are working for a corporation, or you are working for a panchayat, or any management principles are universal in nature. The fundamental principle of planning, organizing, staffing, directing, motivating, controlling, that in some way context change, the nature of challenges change, but they are same. And I think, and I will concede to the gurus of management, who may have a different view, but I do think similar concept applies to leadership. Leadership is relevant to any situation where we have an organized world. It could be a corporation, it could be a nation, it could be an international context. In international context, I think USA and G7 or G20, China now, and now of course India is also very close, having reached the highest growth rate now in these years. I think leadership context is, it could be international, it could be national, it could be for an industry or a sector, it could be for a corporate, multifunctional, multi-dimensional corporate like Tata or Birla or Adani and others as Reliance. It could be for a corporation, it could be for a department, it could be for a plant. So the leadership, principle of leadership and basic attributes of leadership, to my mind, would have a similar approach as universality principle of management, that you need these attributes. Now, all of us have done IT now. In IT, you have some basic features and you have some customized features. So the context can change, customization can change, but basic ingredients of leadership quality, I'm sure in this book could have emerged, that irrespective of what type of function you are doing, irrespective of what sector you are working, irrespective of what country you are working or what state you are working, but definitely the challenges will be different. Suppose you are a corporation in a dictatorial country, a dictator like we had Uganda long back, you have a different challenge. And we were working in a democratic country like India, or another democratic country like United States. Of course, United States is democratic, but not only democratic. Question is, you have Obama as the president and you have the new president, so context is changing. So absolutely, the basic ingredients remaining same. Challenge, nature of challenge, the context will change, and therefore there will be certain attributes to which people will have to adapt. Have to reorient, navigate, whatever phrase you use, but it will change. But for a leader to be successful, over now, I work from now 68, from 68 to now, it works out to how many? Almost 50 years.
Yeah.
50 years.
49.
Huh? 49 years. Next year, I can celebrate 50 years of professional. Basic ingredients to my mind, I was just trying to figure out. It's very difficult to say which is a better quality, which is a better attribute. So don't get into ranking of these attributes. But what I call as the basic attributes, or to give a better phrase, universality principle of leadership quality, basic ingredients would be essential for a successful leader. Not toxic leaders. Dr. Pritam Singh and Mrs. Bhandarkar, Ms. Bhandarkar, they have written a wonderful book, ODC, Leadership ODC. I think that was also released about a year ago. And there, of course, I objected to the, when they were doing this and they had an interview with me, I objected to calling a leader toxic leader. I said, if he is toxic, then he is not a leader. That was my debate, but of course, as I said, that on these issues, I do raise points, but because I am not the guru of that subject, I concede to those who are guru of the subject. So finally, they kept the toxic leader and virtuous leader. Virtuous. So I think virtuous leaders, what Dr. Pritam Singh has said in his book, would have, according to me, many attributes, but some of the attributes I was jotting down, which will be common. How far we will be able to imbibe in them, cultivate in them, train them, assign them job that motivates them to learn. It will vary from individual to individual, but these basic attributes of a successful leader, a virtuous successful leader, not a toxic leader, will be, according to me, humility, humbleness. First attribute will be humility. That's number one. I have seen very successful doctors, very successful scientists, very successful engineers who have made a mark. We have to learn from them, emulate that quality to the best extent that we can. That's very important, I think. I have seen Dr. Kalam, I have seen some of the eminent doctors, scientists, humility. Second attribute would be, which may be a derivative of that, but as I said, that it was a mountain for me also to figure out what I think in the last 50 years of my working should be attribute or is the attribute of the successful. Respect. Must respect individuals. It could be at any level, but you must respect it. That is again coming out of that. Third, I don't put third, I will go on, but it is not in the order of ranking. Not in the order of merit. A good listener. We have very successful leader, I want to name even in today's context, in political system as well as non-political system, very successful leader. But there we can't give that scope. Good listener. If we are not good listener, it will be unlikely that the best of you is coming out. You will still succeed, you will make something, good result, good outcome, but perhaps the outcome could be better if one was having that. Good listener, and next is good articulator. That's also important. We have to motivate people. Like Mr. Modi is a good articulator, good communicator. I'm not sure, good listener, I don't know, so because I have not the occasion to be with him. But articulator, we all we are seeing. Then, thinker with clear direction. A leader cannot afford to be confused in giving direction, and clarity of thought and clarity of direction is a must. Accessible. This is again very difficult, the other one that I am saying. Accessible can be, but some of them are not, many of them are not, but it's still successful. But if they were, it would be better. The next that I am saying, we should respect dissent. That is very difficult. Many of us are victim of this bad quality. We are very good, we do well, we feel happy, but people should agree with us. So very few of us, and those who have, I think they can, they excel well, according to me, we should accept dissent. In fact, for a better decision-making process, let me go a step further, we should encourage dissent, not only accept dissent. So you imagine, there are people who don't accept. I am saying not only acceptance of dissent, but encouraging dissent, so that people get different perspective for our own decision-making process to be rich, for decisions to be rich. Developer of people, that again is very important. Like Sinha is a developer of people. Developer of people. There are other leaders in all sectors that are developer of people. And there comes the question of, you should be a good delegator. This I have strongly believed in my life. Delegate. Delegating to your people down the line has number of virtues for the organization and for the success of the style of functioning or the style of leadership. I think you can call it, Dr. Vidukshi will call that phrase as empowering, I will call it as delegating, whatever phrase you use, but I think essentially be at the same time. Fair, equitable and fair. If we behave in a manner that I am becoming a little too much for somebody, very harsh for somebody else. I mean, by and large, your decisions should be accepted by people, particularly if it relates to human resources. Okay? All through the organization, it has to be fair and equitable. Of course, ethical, ethics. Team man, you should be a team man. And one thing that I picked up, I mean, there are many things that I picked up in many books, leading by example. I mean, if I only preach and I myself have preached 20 years, then it does make sense. And this, I never end of my thought like this unless I definitely make it a point to convey. And Dr. Pritul will be clear me out. Wherever I have occasion to talk on human relations, wherever I have occasion to talk on managerial effectiveness or leadership, one principle that I definitely emphasize, for me, I try. I won't say I succeed always. I try. Empathy. Many of us, we feel that treatment to me should be like this. The boss should treat me like this, colleagues should treat me like this, subordinate should treat me like this. But when it comes to I doing the same thing, I forget all that. This is a very, very difficult and demanding quality from an individual. But we can forgive if that is not available at other level of the organization. But it cannot be forgiven if it is not available abundantly at the level of successfully. Empathize. If you think this treatment is bad to you, think the same way when you are dealing with the people. That's my few thoughts on about a dozen issues, but as I said, I struggle to jot down what I should say on leadership. So far as this book is concerned, it's a marvelous thing. I complimented when this book was launched, Leadership Odyssey, because when we were students of management, of course we are always students of management, but former students of management, we always learned like Harvard, Dr. Grant, and occasion and privilege of doing Harvard. Even in IIM Ahmedabad and others, which is supposed to be the mother of our management institution, all case studies, all books from USA and from other countries. I think it's a great thing for India that our management gurus and management thinkers have started writing on the basis of contextualizing on the basis of experiences, good and bad, in Indian context. Indian context definitely is different. As I said, that the basic ingredients of leadership may be irrespective of context, but customization is equally important. It's equally important. So therefore, when that book came, Mr. Sinha's previous book came, now the new book is coming, there are many other books that are coming. It's a great thing for India to be celebrating this, and I congratulate the authors for doing such a great job and BIMTEC to facilitate. I didn't know 23 round tables across, including various sectors, and then trying to get the wisdom. But I didn't of course, I didn't dislike, but when you are saying the softer part of thing, instead of diamond of wisdom, you should say pearl of wisdom. So, diamond and 3D model, you said say pearl and 3D model. Science is a little harsh, art is a little softer side. So, I think that's the better thing. So, all the best and congratulations.
Thank you.
In words, what would you like to say to may I now have the privilege of inviting our chief guest, Padma Bhushan, Dr. M.B. Athreya, to please launch the book.
That's great. Everybody printed. Packing was done by us. Would you mind coming here for a picture?
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
It is indeed a pleasure to invite on stage Mrs. Chitra Sinha to receive this prized volume from our chief guest, Dr. Athreya.
I thought he was not old enough to retire. When I meet his wife, he's even younger.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You will have to censor that comment.
Thank you, Mr. Shahi, for agreeing to be with us for a few more minutes. As a token of our gratitude.
Kamal Singh is sitting here. Arvind ji, three authors sitting here. And I also see Banan, and I also see Vaikanath sitting somewhere. And I also see Siddiqui. And many, many old friends sitting in barriers. So I think that KK said that you will be knowing most of the persons, so I said yes, I know most of the persons. So MP also met me, and I also said that 9% sitting here. I think the first time I met Mr. Sinha, and he was not knowing about me, but his brother told me that my brother is in Bokaro. And after being very tired for about 3 days in the cold belt, I was doing some kind of work for this self-hardworking group. And Bhupen was also with me. I said, okay, let me go, because his brother has been talking to him about if I went and I was in hurry, so he said, no, you can't go without having a cup of tea. That was my first meeting, and I talked to him. After that, I moved to administrative staff college of India, Hyderabad, and he came there and he was the deputy general manager. And he spent about a week with us, and we were doing some kind of tea group. And while doing tea group, I told that Mr. Sinha, okay, one day you are going to be a great guy. And today I feel very good that you have become a great writer. One thing more which I would like to say, if something goes into the head of Mr. Sinha, I think that it goes on and on, on and on, on and on, in the person of the Karma Yogi. I'm using the word Karma Yogi. Listen, I want that in the MTBC, my 75% people must have some kind of MBA program. And I think that you have to do something. So I said that, okay, I think that I saw a very big picture of Ganesha in his room. And I said that, yes, KK, it's a fantastic picture of Ganesha. So he came with the request that can IIM start MBA program for the MBC. And that was my last year from IIM Lucknow. So when I found after 2 days, the Ganesha picture was in my room, in my office. So I said, who has sent this one? He said, well, Mr. Sinha has sent it. When you get something without demanding, you feel very obliged. And I was talking with Munj that I haven't learned one thing in my life, how to say no. And I can't say no because whatever I am today, I am today because of my friends who are sitting here. And I would like to die not as a bankrupt man, but I would like to die, you know, not die as an insolvent person. I would like to die as a fully solvent person. So whatever they have done for me, I must pay back, and that is my life. So that's why whenever there is invitation, there's a problem in the family, and this one and that one, and Kamalsi knows about that. But still I say that, you know, I will do it. I think that the greatest crisis of the contemporary world is what? If you ask greatest crisis. I started asking this kind of question in Paris, Frankfurt, Berlin, London, even when we went to Wharton, and Carnegie Mellon, and many places, that what are the greatest crises of the world? 3 crises. And the first crisis was the leadership and the world governance. I'm talking about the guitar, one very, very distinguished speaker. The greatest crisis of the contemporary world is leadership. My children are settled in America, so every day I pick up the call, I said, I hope you are safe in America. You can imagine that. And I always used to say, Mohinj, that you can teach any fool, but not the Americans. And I became quite convinced when the Trump became the president of America. To be honest with you. So the first crisis that was the crisis of the leadership and governance. Ethical governance. 2008. Banks were becoming bankrupt. But the salary was CEO was going up, up, up. Who can believe it? Normal human being can't believe it. And the present crisis in the Infosys is also a reflection of something about that. It's not talking about the salary part, how much money is paid, but it's talking about some injustice and fairness. So this crisis, and you'd be surprised to know that 67% literature in the field of management that has been only around leadership. Somebody asked me that why India
so much prescriptions, right from Mahabharata, you know, Ramayana and Gita. How come to lead a good life? I think that whenever there's a crisis, you see in terms of writing. So the issues applicable to awareness has been right from time immemorial. Five Pandavas, 100 Kauravas. So that's why when you were talking about Manthan, I see Devas and the Rakshasas. You see Ramayana, Rama and Lakshmana, and thousand Rakshasas. So I'm using the word Rakshasas, symbolically I'm using. Well, I used to write once upon a time poetry, so I wrote one line. Deva, Deva hai, Danuja, Danuja hai, Devata, Devata hai, or Rakshas, Rakshas hai. Deva, Deva hai, Danuja, Danuja hai, and Danuja, Deva ke beech manuj hai. We all human beings are symbolic integration of Rakshasas and Devas. And that's why the title like Manthan. Should you go towards the Rakshasa side? Or should you go towards the Devata side? So when you talk about oceanic depth, and when you talk about mountain, and when you talk about those kind of things, brother, I always feel that well, we all have got the problems. And that's why there must be continuous Manthan in your life. There should be continuous Manthan in the organization. And that's why when you saw the Manthan, because when I went to IIM Lucknow, there is one hall that was known as Manthan. There should be continuous Manthan. Continuous reflection. Continuous meditation. The day we stop, we move towards the Rakshasa side. But that is in us. That is in every organization. I haven't to find any organization which can tell me that we are full of only Deva and Deva. After working with about 300 organizations in UK and also in Paris and other places, I have seen everywhere this is happening. Everywhere. What can be done about it? That's why in this context, this book is very, it has got a tremendous amount of contemporary relevance. And must congratulate all the three authors. And most congratulations will be to Mrs. Sinha and Mrs. Soni. And I think that because whatever these guys are today, they are the product of all your efforts, I must tell you. So I must congratulate you. Having said that, let me try to, because I'm a very strong believer, I wrote something about, there is a book on religion, and I'm reading that book on religion, and I have gone more or less all the religions, right from Islam, Zoroastrianism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, and I may write a book, Cross-Cultural Similarity in Religion, or Cross-Religion Similarity. Because intellectual's mind is a very, very crooked mind. They would like to see the differences. They can't see similarity. That's how we are, our mind is trained by all the theory of science, mathematics, and more so about psychology, that you must choose the variables, they must differentiate. If they don't differentiate, they are not the relevant variables. That's why beautifully I say that our capability to see the beauty has gone up, gone down. If I use the science of my power of my mind, you bring the most beautiful woman in front of me. I will say after watching, say, oh, I know, had it been like that, she could have been more beautiful. Science makes you see the differences, not the beauty. Analysis, this is the major problem of analysis. That's why very jokingly I say, the power of mind has grown 1,000 times. But the power of soul has equally shrunk 1,000 times. Where is the soul? Where is the power of soul? And that's why I always say, women are the better leader because they don't have moustache and they have got a larger soul than us. That's why the greatest example of the contemporary world, I can give the example of Gandhi. And I would be requesting all of you to go and see the movie. At least I have seen that movie 150 times. And more I see that movie, more inside I get. And I could see that movie. When in Johannesburg, around 12 o'clock in the night, cold night, when he was thrown out from the compartment, I say, luckily he was not MBA. Luckily he was not MBA. Otherwise he could have done the decision tree analysis. I will do this one, this will be the outcome, this will be the outcome. Gandhi could hear the silent voice of his soul. And he began. Same thing I could see that I met actually our former late Prime Minister Chandrasekhar. So while talking to him, he told me something very interesting. I was discussing, and he told me in Hindi, Pritam, antim satya ki khoj mein apna jeevan barbaad mat karo. Antim satya ki khoj mein apna jeevan barbaad mat karo. Kuch karo. Science has trained us to have the ultimate truth, which no one knows about it. Let me come back about this book, you know. I thought that somewhere I think R.V. Sahib wrote me, and that's why I always tell come up. Don't make me the last speaker, whatever I prepare, I forget about that, and I will change my book. Someone asked a question to Janaka that who is a great king? And the reply of Janaka was, no king can be a great king without being a great philosopher. Philosopher mind is extremely important. And I see in this book the mind of a philosopher and the mind of a king. And that's where I was quite impressed with that. Not only that, in the olden time, you take about the Babylonian civilization, Chinese civilization, Roman civilization, Indian civilization, when things used to be appointed, normally there used to be two questions. Is he a great warrior? If the reply is yes. The second thing that, and on the top of that, has he got philosophical mind? Has he got artistic mind? If he has got the artistic mind, philosophical mind, and being a warrior, he can do it. That's why artistic mind is important. Artistic mind is important. How to see beauty in everyone? How to see power in everyone? And I like this book because this book has been very powerfully contextualized. Contextualizing the book requires tremendous amount of wisdom. That was said by Chalukya, Buddha, Machiavelli, Socrates. You must understand the context. And that's why the customization which Arvind Sahi was talking about that takes place. A beautiful example I gave because I wrote my first book, Transformational Leaders, and Mr. Modi was one of the characters in that book. And Modi used to be quoted everywhere, what a great leader, what a great leader. The same Mr. Modi did not succeed so much when he became the chairman of the India. Because he couldn't customize his style with the context. So context is important. That's why I see in this book very seven powerful context. I was reading those seven powerful contexts. he, one context was that business world is full of turbulence today. It's a conflict, confluence of ambiguities, uncertainties. And so it's a conflict, ambiguities, uncertainties, and not knowing. So what will happen? How to manage this turbulent world? You need a very different kind of mindset. You can't have a formula. You can't have the basic principle. That's why managing ambiguities, uncertainties, and complexities, they all have talked about that. The world is full of ambiguities, uncertainties, and complexities. Powerfully they do it. The second thing they said, we are in a global world. The globe is flat. The world is flat. Right? It's a boundarylessness. There's a boundarylessness. To find that, we must have leaders who could have the mind of being a boundarylessness wisdom. How to build that? Second context they have said that. Beautifully. This was a very powerful contextualization, so I was, you all three have done a very great job in contextualizing. Last year, when you talk about the conclusion, but fine, then I did the backward integration. As a strategy man, I said, where to reach? So then I do always the backward integration. So I did the backward integration. Whether these issues and context, whether they are being managed or not, and they are in the different chapters. Another contextualization was, you must start building the leader today or tomorrow. You must peep into future. Those who look into future, those who peep into future, they survive tomorrow. Those who think of tomorrow, they survive today very well. Those who think of all the time yesterday, they spoil the today as well as tomorrow. Another point which I see, managing diversity is a going to be the most critical kind of things. And some BJP fellow, he made this statement. I said that I think that he needs God's worst chapel. When he made that, in India we have been in a highly cosmopolitan place, we have been living with people who have got black skin and this one, that. I said, what this man is talking about? Diversity can be the diversity of the skin, diversity of religion, diversity of thinking, diversity of gender, diversity of generations. Because I was talking to Mr. Bhatnagar one day, Bhatnagar is here from that. I can see, I could see Bhatnagar.
He is there.
So he was saying that we have got three generation people in the ATPC. And the previous, I don't want to name the director, he said, well, Dr. Singh, you really don't know about these young fellows. They join today and they want to buy a motorbike or they want to buy a scooter or they want to buy a car. Do you know, when I joined the NTPC, there used to be one cycle, some people left it. And I think that I was instructed, there's a cycle here and we use that one. So that was the era. So then you can see the diversity of thinking, diversity of generation. Find that central kind of context they have done beautifully. Another thing which they have done is corrupting leaders with tremendous amount of integrating mindset. That's where they are using the word holistic leaders and so on. And that's why your example of Buddhist story about nine blinds and the elephant. It's a very powerful story about that. It's so powerful I can't tell you that. So I think that you read that one, you can see that the stories are there. Another thing which I find, and that was something very great, that managing innovation. So I could see, if I see the contextualization, if you see, I see your 3D theory, I see the context, I see the processes and the strategies, and I could also see the goal. So all three, they have been beautifully summarized. That's the reason. Now, coming back to focusing on the book, I read about 4 or 5 slokas, and it was amazing. And I was not knowing, Mr. Sinha, that you have got that kind of insight about Indian slokas and something like that. And 3 slokas which I like the most, that amantra maksara nasti. There is not even a single mantra which doesn't have the power of mantra. So amantra maksara nasti, nasti mula manosana. There is not even a single plant which doesn't have the same plant. My last 3rd line is really interesting. Ayogyo purusaha nasti. Not even a single person who is incompetent. And your story of the Skurin, Ramayana, is a very fantastic story. That he is also doing something. Skurin is also doing something. That it's a strength of that. Am I doing whatever I can do it? Am I appreciated by it for that? I may not say mountains, but I can have some pebbles and trees. Beautiful story, I see that. That was another thing that, so ayogyo purusaha nasti. All human beings are competent human beings. The last line, yoga, just to show you. It's difficult to find a person like A.K. Sinha, or ready to build. That is very rare. That's extremely rare. Janmana jayate sudra. Every human being is sudra by birth. Nobody is born as a very wise person. We all are sudra. That's why sanskara, sanskara, that makes him busy. That's the concept of reborn. Harvard psychologist has used the concept of reborn. So long that there is a continuous rebirth, and rebirth, and rebirth, we are between Brahmins. Rich. And Bheda Bhyasa Bhavet Vipra. By learning, you become depth wise person. And another one, Brahmana Janati Brahmana. The moment we understand the meaning of life, we become true Brahmins. Only, I think that day before, I was requested by IOC chairman and the directors and the EDs who were retiring. I said, retiring word is a very stupid word. Because you are going to create a new purpose in your life. It's always a new purpose in your life. So one purpose, before one purpose dies, you must create the new purpose. And I told them, it's high time for you to go with your wife for about a month or 4th honeymoon or 100th honeymoon when you go there and spend a time for about a month there, you and your wife, and you talk about that, what kind of new purpose you are going to create. And you must have seen Saral's program. It's fascinating movie. When he came to IMI for lecture, he said that any movie, I have done many movies, but the movie which you like the most, like Sara, there is at least one wise man who quoted my best movie at very hard, Sarans. Otherwise, people don't talk about Sarans. People talk about other movies like that. How do you make new purpose? Life is nothing. It's a creative new purpose. Life is nothing. It's a creative new purpose. How to do it? It's important. It's a really important issue. and those who do it, they create purpose. You see, Gandhi movie, fascinating movie, when he came back from Lokhali and after something, and I think that the journalist asked a question, the interviewer asked a question, what next? And he said, what? I'm going to Pakistan. Before the one purpose dies, can we create a second purpose? And I must also, I've got some problem with you because I wanted to appoint him in IMI. And then he told me that, sir, I think that I have the offer from Winter, and I said, yes. So I said, okay. He goes with the mind.
Thank you, sir.
That's why someone wrote about Gandhi. Chal pade jidharto dharmat pak. Chal pade koti pak usi road. People follow purpose. People don't follow people. I follow my wife because wife is a purpose in my life. I follow my children because they are the purpose in my life. How to create purpose, that's important. That is one thing that I have seen. And somewhere, I don't know why you quoted that one, but I think that you could have also given some context of Maharaja. And when Dhritarashtra asked a question to Sanjaya, who is going to win? You have quoted that line. But some a slight more, you know, elaboration could have been very good. Who is going to win? And he did not take even 5 seconds. So mighty king, Pandavas are going to win and Kauravas are going to lose. He said, what nonsense you are talking about? Do you know who are Kauravas? Bhishma, Dronacharya, Kripacharya, Ashwatthama, and such great warriors are going to be defeated by those 5 Pandavas. But when God slightly relaxed, he said that, Sanjaya, if you are making some statement, there must be some reason in that. Well, I know that you are a very wise person. What made you say so that? And that's where you have put, yatra yogeshwara krishna, and yatra patho dhanudhara, and tat sri vijayo bhuti, and who are you feeling? It's my eminent belief, where we have got yogeshwara krishna, yoga parmasukosra, where we have got Arjuna, very meditating, concentrating, a mind of the Gabrata. That's where we are going to have victory. In our life also, how it's important. In the ordination also, how it's important. So I'd like to say one thing. I was quite enamored by the book, by the quotational part, and by the references which you cited from Vedas, which you also cited from Gita, and from other kind of things. There is amazing kind of things. And perhaps you are not aware, when I got this Moscow Award, Global Thought Leader Award, that's they consider, Moscow University considers, it's next to Nobel Prize, that a man heard me in France, where I was talking about agelessness, timelessness, absolute wisdom. And whatever you have said, it has a tremendous amount of agelessness, timelessness, and boundlessness. Of course, with the purpose of what? Some kind of customization. That's what context of context is important. And when you come there, the last chapter, you know that you find something fine. Last chapter is what? Epilogue. Epilogue. Both are very important. So you read epilogue and prologue, and you can get both, because both are connected or not. So I always see as a scientist whether they are connected or not, whatever he says. So you say that in the that leaders must have wealth creating mind. Because we are in the business of creating wealth. And that's why we say Arthakarishwa Vidya. Whatever wisdom you have got, whatever your knowledge you have got, it must create earth, it must create wealth. Wealth for the nation, wealth for the organization, wealth for the society, not wealth for you. So let's take your mind that you said. You put the word ethical governance, and I think that since you all three have done a lot of work, I'm tempting you for another book when you write that we 19th sloka in Gita. He said, now you all great commanders to collectively save the life of Bhishma. And I was asking a question in the research, said, why save the life of Bhishma? The lingua could have been annihilated, Pandavas, kill them, destroy them. Why they saved the life of Bhishma? Because Bhishma had been in some ways the embodiment of Dharma. And he was doing so like Dharma is alive. Or was everybody conquered? So there you are, when you talk about ethical governance, and that's a very, very important. How to build ethical governance? If you want to become a long distance runner, ethical governance is in the point which you read, and I call it five mantras you have given. You haven't used the word mantra, but I see as a mantra that faith in people power, and that school example is a good example. Immense faith in people power. And if you try to read Fortune 500 companies, the list of 500 companies appearing in the Fortune 500, you could see that 1915. I tried to see 213, you'll be surprised to know only 14% companies survived. Rest were out from that list. And I was doing some kind of study about that, and that's where I found that faith in people, building people power, was the key factor. You can call it culture now, building people power, and that's where in the also give an example of culture. And the last point which you said that Gita said, and that's where integration of IQ, integration of EQ, integration of SQ, and integration of that soul. So you said all these four, you said that all are important. And the last line which you have, beautifully summarized, how mind is what humanity. How to bring humility? That's why we say, Varsa hi jara bhumi niraye, jatha nama hi udvidya paaye, bunda ghat sahay gir kaise, halke bachar sahay sahay se. The hall mark of being a great man is what? Humility. And that's why if a driver shows humility, don't care about that. But suppose CMD shows the humility, say, what a great man. Automatically you say, what a great man is. It's a CMD, but it's still full of humility. Humility is a very, very gracious ability. It's a very difficult to convert. So that's why you find the humility, the last one which you have said, humility. It's a fantastic. So you find that he was using the word bird. I will be saying that you have created a Rudraksh Mala of five nuggets. I will use the word Rudraksh Mala of five nuggets. Only one area, all those fellows who are sitting here from the management schools, and those who are sitting here, and those who are the trainers, those who are the consultants, Sinha has given a very powerful challenge. And maybe that your next conference can be that. And he has used the word, leadership can't be taught. And I saw that one challenging everyone, those who are in that profession. Challenging everyone in that profession. And I remember very well, I was doing some sales workshop, and directors were there, the CMD was there. So one fellow was very, very, I mean, naughty kind of person, so he came and asked me, Dr. Singh, ye aapka dhanda kab tak chalta rahega? Humne bola ki jab tak tum jaise manager rahoge, hamara dhanda hamesha chalta rahega. I would like to make one point, please. Isko dekhiye, that how leadership can be taught, I think that we have to find out. Maybe your next one, now once you're there, and I would like to say that your next sojourn, your next policy, or your next journey should be organized some kind of all-India level workshop, inviting all the business leaders, those who are proving leaders that if you have made the statement, I am concluding you have made the statement with tremendous amount of insight. The way leadership taught, leadership can be taught. They agreed. The way leadership is taught, leadership can be taught. You teach leadership, and you all have taught very good Kula and this one and that one and that one. I think that the management schools need to re-examine and they do their own mantra. Maybe you can bring out another book about pedagogy of training, grooming, sculpting leaders who can make the difference in the world. With these few words, I think that I would like to congratulate all the three great women who spared their husbands, because it's also a tapasya. When anybody needs to do anything, it's also a tapasya. I was talking with Mr. Preya, and I said, whatever he is today, he is there because of him. But fine, that you also be very, very grateful for their contributions, for their support. And I hope, madams, you will remind me. Well, another book, you know, continuously, that you actually, I would suggest to you that you remind them that they are capable of doing writing great books. Last Harbans is a person, I think that I joined in India, and he is in AICT. So normally, AICT people, they are very good policemen. I could see that there was a person here I see. He was looking after our MB. And I think that the amount of help which he did, that was an enormous amount. The third one, you go with any proposal, you go with any request, the other says, go ahead and do it. And come back and ask me that what help you want to do. That has been a great, you know, something very, something touches in our heart. I think that about you, that conference, we were doing about the child issues and challenges in the energy sector. So he sent his great brother for his city to extend it to take the course. I don't know what could inspire him. He said, sir, I want to take the course. And he said, can I send that card? So he sent that. One day I called him and I said, that, look, I would like to have, because we have built a temple in my village, so I would like to have good people on top of my house. And is it possible for you to do something? He said, can you show me? He took that. And I must also say, the amount of money and time he must have spent in army service. He said, you have to pay for your house, you have to pay for your house. Sir, how much money do you need? If you have money, you will have to pay for your house. Sir, you have to pay for your house. He said, you have to pay for your house. अगर मैं अपने पिताजी का फोटो ला आपको किसी आदमी से बताऊँ आपको देखिए फ्रेंड्स आई थिंक दैट लेट्स कम टू मीट मिस्टर सिन्हा एंड ऑल द टू ग्रेट ऑथर्स अराउंड विद हिम एंड रिक्वेस्ट आई एम यूजिंग योर रिक्वेस्ट टू ब्रिंग आउट अनदर
The authors have spent countless days and nights compiling, writing, and editing this book. Let us listen to what they have to say on this fulfilling occasion. I begin with Mr. Indraneel Mitra, AGM NTPC PMI.
One of the qualities we need to add to the long list that Mr. Shahi gave in leadership
is good time management. We are now 40 minutes behind schedule, and I had cautioned Mr. Sinha that when you have some very eminent speakers, it will run out of control, and nobody will have the courage to intervene, send a slip or remind. So at least the compere should remind the speakers, the writers, that they have 5 minutes according to the schedule that I have seen. When we start speaking, I fully empathize with you. We can't
finish. Motion. Dr. Gupraya, Dr. Shri, Dr. Kripasil, Mr. Kamal Singh, Dr. Chaturvedi, and my fellow authors. We have already heard a lot about the book and various facets of leadership and opinions of our eminent and distinguished dignitaries on the subject. So, if I may, if you permit me, I will just talk a little about the philosophical aspects of it. Every body of knowledge, whether we call it a science or an art, must have a philosophy that underpins it. What is our philosophy in Mantra? Well, I believe that the notion of leaders and leadership developed quite differently in modern management thought as compared to the Eastern philosophical tradition. In modern management, initially, the concept of a leader was that of one who led from the front. Leadership, by example, we heard about at the head of the troops. Whereas in our philosophy, leadership was also about guidance, direction, influence, and suggestions. You can refer to the role of Lord Krishna in the Mahabharata, as has been quoted by Dr. Pritam Singh, as evidence of this. Then, it's not only the Indian philosophy. We can talk about China also, and the words of the great Chinese sage Lao Tzu, who was the father of Taoism. He wrote 1200 years ago. Though his words also very relevant. To lead the people, walk behind them. Let them achieve. Let them take the credit. And they will perform miracles for you again and again. Through much of Manthan, we have tried to relate modern leadership with the leadership principles, precepts, and practices for ancient Indian philosophy. As Mr. Kamal Singh has said, we believe that the best of Indian business leaders have imbibed these through our rich cultural tradition. And consequently, although they have absorbed the best from modern management thought, the style of leadership that they practice is uniquely their own. Draws from our Indian world. What makes it different? Well, there is a sense of regret for society, as Mr. Kamal Singh has talked about, and of building the community, working for a higher purpose than merely to grow the business. And this fits in well, very well with our concept in our Indian philosophy, the concept of the rain. We say that we are under a fivefold debt to the gods, to the spirits, to our ancestors, to all living beings, and to the environment for allowing us to exist. And we should so live in a manner that we are able to discharge some of this debt. So, the best of our leaders are work in this spirit. And when you work for a higher purpose, it makes you humble. Because you think there is something bigger than yourself. We have heard Dr. Kitam Singh talking about the humility, Mr. Shahi also. And so another striking feature is humility, which is also being taught in India since times immemorial by the gurus and the gurukuls, with young princes and leaders. At the risk of some more Sanskrit shlokas, I will just, if you will bear with me for a minute. I will quote the sutras of the incomparable Chanakya. Sutra, very short statements which the guru used to teach the guru, the shishas, and the shishas used to repeat. You can almost picture the shishas sitting at the feet of the gurus and chanting these sutras again and again. The first sutra is Sukhasya Bolam Dharma. The essence of happiness is ethical gain, not profits, not riches, not material things. The essence of happiness is ethical gain. Sukhasya Bolam Dharma. The second sutra, Dharmasya Bolam Artha. What is this? The essence of dharma is art. The essence of ethical behavior is resources. Why? Because you can't talk about dharma to a person on an empty stomach. If a person doesn't have food to eat, or clothes to wear, or shelter to sleep in, then it's useless trying to convince him about modern and ethical behavior. And therefore, the task of a leader is that he should make sure that his followers have their requirements met before he can talk about dharma and modern and ethical work. In the third sutra, Arthasya Mulam Rajya, the essence of earth, the essence of wealth is kingdom. In our modern context, we will say enterprise. The essence of wealth is enterprise. Because that is what generates the wealth for you. And not only as a leader, but part of that wealth has to be given to the followers also, so that their material needs are met and they can start thinking about higher things, the higher order needs of master, etc. And then after that, in the next sutra, just bear with me for a minute and you'll see where this is going. The next sutra, the fourth one, Rajya Mulam Indriya Jaya, Indriya Jaya, the essence of ruling a kingdom is conquering the senses. Conquering means disciplining the senses. So, the essence of a leader is not getting swayed by the senses, not giving way to anger or passion or greed. And Indriya Jayasya, next sutra, Indriya Jayasya Moolam Vinaya, the essence of disciplining the senses is moral and ethical training, Vinaya. And Vinayasya Moolam Vruttopaseva, the essence of moral training is serving the elders. And why serve the elders? Because it teaches humility, which are scriptures hold to be an essential characteristic of enlightened leadership. So I come back to the humility, and after this I would like to quote again Lao Tzu. The leader should be like a river, quietly flowing, finding a way around and over obstacles, smoothly guiding, but always purposeful, always finding a way. As we say, water always finds a way, the leader will always find a way. Was there ever a clearer vision of steadfast resolve, of indomitable will? And we also see now that modern management thought has come around to the concept of servant leadership as practiced and preached by Mahatma Gandhi, when we have authors in modern management thoughts who say that a leader exists to meet the needs of his followers. It's the same thing as servant leadership. Further, I would also like to quote the well-known book, Good to Great. Jim Collins, the author, describes the highest level of leadership, level 5 leadership, as a combination of humility and intense professional will. The same principles that Chanakya and Lao Tzu taught centuries ago. So, we see, of course, I mean, we see the principles behind leadership. And of course, leadership can never be static. We learn much from modern management also, such as the various sections in the book about change management, building global leaders, driving innovation, building diversity. We have tried to bring out these aspects also. And of course, many eminent HR leaders shared their views on different aspects of leadership in the series of HR roundtables organized by BIMTEC that were the genesis of this book. These are also of great value and they give us plenty of food for thought. And in the end, I believe that Manthan will be very useful to management students as well as practicing managers in exploring the different dimensions of leadership and adapting the diamond and 3D models that we have conceptualized to suit their own requirements, the context that we have adopted. Thank you very much.
Quiz for all of you. 2,190 days, 6 Delhi marathons, 6 Mumbai marathons, 1 Golden Jubilee, 2 Prime Ministers, and a 70th birthday. What is this? Any guesses? Quick ones. I just have another 4 minutes, 40 seconds to go.
Your book took that long?
Yeah, 6 years. 3 years of 12 round tables and another 3 years of writing the book.
You sure was 70,
right? Yeah, that's right. We had a lot more collective amount of hair on our head, 50% reduction in that. Facial hair has gone up by 100% because of Professor Sinha growing the mustache. Okay, a few things that I want to say. I'll only talk about these few words, Manthan, art and science, developing leaders. Manthan, as you all know, dictionary meaning is churning. As you all have read in your early life about Manthan, asuras, suras, using the mountain and churning the ocean. And really, we churned the ocean. We had about more than 60 panelists who came and talked at our 12 conferences. I said 12 because the 23 conferences were divided into two parts, 12 which were on this topic, and then 11 so far which have been on more broader human resources. So the 12 conferences we did, there were more than 60 leaders, CEOs, human resources, academics, who came and talked about this topic. Really, this was the topic we talked about, art and science of developing leaders. So once we are after 12 sessions had that knowledge, we had to churn it. And we have to churn it to bring out some good, and which is really this book all about. So that is one thing I wanted to talk about, which is our effort to really churn this into a piece of knowledge for everybody. And when I say everybody, I mean this is targeted at youngsters. This book is targeted at youngsters who are wanting to bring out, who are wanting to create really a diamond out of the rough diamond that they have. So they'll smoothen the edges. Create great luster. So for young people who want to bring out that leadership in themselves, this book is for them. This book is for the senior leaders who have led their organizations with great aplomb, but want to leave a legacy behind now. This book is also for HR practitioners who want to create a great process of leadership, a culture of leadership in their organizations. So those are the three target audience we have. Coming to what is this book about? All of you would have heard about leaders are not born, they are made. We, in a way, differ. We believe leaders are born. Each one of us has leadership within us. It is about that germ is there. It is about how much of water we give, how much of nutrition we give to bring that leadership out. And this book is really about that. For this, we went into the mythology, we went into Chanakya Sutra, we went into Bhagavad Gita, we went into Vedanta at large. On the other hand, we went into most modern research, top 20 for leaders. I've led that research with Aon Hewitt for almost 15, 14 years that I was there. So we looked at all of that, and what found was that the ultimate truth doesn't differ. The ultimate truth lies in what our scriptures teach us. And from there, we developed a three-dimensional model of leadership, which is about depth, which is about moral discipline, and which is about dynamism. So those three aspects we brought out, and for more, I wouldn't say much. Dr. Pritham Singh has talked a lot about it. And there is this book you can read when you go back, and you can order from Amazon. But because it was multifaceted, because there were three dimensions we were talking about, therefore, a unidimensional approach couldn't have done, and therefore it needed three of us. Three of us bring in very different dimensions from the way we've grown up, and that those three dimensions, hopefully you'll see, as the book flows from India way into transformation, into diversity, into innovation, and other topics. We've had great fun. We've had great fun in writing this book from the starting day. I remember 6 years back, Professor Sinha called me up. I was roaming around in a car in Gurgaon, and he called up and said, you know what, I want to start a series of conferences across the country. What should be the topic? I said, leadership. That's the topic. That's the key. And he said, okay, then what should be the heading? And what came out of my mouth was really here. Art and Science of Developing Leaders. That's where it all started, and here we are today. It's been fun traveling together in this journey with my co-authors. However, more than 100 people have contributed to this book. It's not about us. Actually, we are nothing but for those 100 people. I talked about the 60 panelists who talked, and then there has been BIMTEC, of course, led by Dr. Chaturvedi here, and many other people who've helped us in this journey of the conferences that we did. Aon Hewitt, a lot of research that we have there put forward, entire top company for leaders comes from Aon Hewitt. Sandeep Chaudhary, Anand Shankar, Sushil Bhaseen, a special mention, Shashwat, you are there, please do carry that. Sushil Bhaseen was the guy who helped us carve out the flow. Oh, where is Sushil? Here he is. Who helped us carve out the flow of the book 3 years back. So thank you, Sushil. Gitansh, Rick Payne, Tanishk Mohan, Radhika Gopalakrishnan, Sushant, Nidhi, Priyanka, many, many people, and of course, a galaxy of people from BIMTEC as an institute. So that's more than 100 people have contributed to this book. It's not about three of us, it is really about them. I really, from bottom of my heart, thank all of you for being here. You are friends, you are families of three of us. And it really gladdens our heart that each one of you are here. At 6 minutes, 15 seconds, I stop. Thank you.
Our third author, Professor K.K. Sinha, is Dean Development at BIMTEC. This is his second book, the first being My Experiments with Unleashing People Part. Sir, can we have you on stage, please? Sinha.
So, silence. After so much of listening about the book, so much of churning in the hall itself about the book. And I must really compliment, first of all, my panelists here on the dais. Honorable Padma Bhushan Athreyasa. It was so nice immediately when I approached him with the idea of the book. And content, he immediately agreed to provide a foreword. You were honored to this work by offering a foreword. Mr. Athreya, Dr. Pritham Singh, Mr. Arvi Shahi, and Kamal Singh, and Dr. Harivansh Chaturvedi. They have been wonderful people. They have been wonderful people. They have been my teachers virtually. I have either had a Dronacharya Arjun relationship with him or perceived Eklavya Dronacharya relationship. I might be a distant learner, but I have been learning from them. And that learning that has been coming out again and again and again and again, at the provocation of my wife, and of course, insisted on my wife Chitra, she, in the mid of 70s, I think some pundit told her that I will write a book, and she was after me. She was always chasing me that write a book, and I came out with a book published in 1980 sometime, and you know it was a poetry book. And she said, no, nothing going, no poetry needed anymore, I am married to you already. And again she kept on pushing me up. And I came up with another book, which is the second book, which nobody knows, perhaps, in the 90s. And there was again a poetry book. Look. I told that I'm glad that everybody is admiring a philosopher here in the leadership context. But indeed, a philosopher is needed. And she kept on chasing me tirelessly. And I'm really complimenting you. I don't know where she's gone. Yeah. So I'm really complimenting you for bringing out these two professional books, so-called professional books, but laden with all the philosophies that I have had, learned over a period of time at the hands of gurus, either as an Eklavya or Arjun, whatever. But thank you very much, all of you. I have my family here, Lal Saab, Tulivya, my respect, regard. You made it, I was rough. I was also coming with your oxygen cylinder and everything ready. I must admire you. Thank you very much. It makes me so happy about this and all my family members who are here, folks, friends, colleagues, ex-companies, and dear panelists and friends like Dwarka, like I don't see, I like Siddiqui, Saklian Bhai, and I'm missing him, I think. And so many of them, Dhananjay, and my whole band of colleagues from BIMTEC, and my neighborhood, I mean, that's a wonderful family that we have developed over a period of very little time, but those 38 are really terrible guys here who have been like a family. You have all been teaching us. I've been continuously learning from all of you. And ultimately, I would like to then talk about my co-authors, Ajay and Indraneel. Yeah? It was difficult to tie them up. Ajay rightly mentioned so much of digression, so much of diversions that we went on. I used to always remember a story. For the second book, I got an award by giving some Hindi books. Those days, it was in the college, you get, there was a book called Gyara Sapno Ka Desh, Land of 11 Dreams. And it was an experimental era in the literature of Hindi. And they came out with a book written by 10 authors, 10 eminent authors of Hindi. You wrote a novel. They said, first chapter, X will write, B chapter, Dharmveer Bharti, second chapter with, what is that, Yadav, Rajendra Yadav, and so many, so on and so forth. Everybody will write a chapter and pass on to the next, and pass on to the next, and pass on to the next. Then the book would have come to Dharmveer Bharti again to close it. And I remember, I think, sixth or seventh was Rajendra Yadav, who wrote very amusingly that when I read the six authors' book, chapters, each one of them connecting new story and new story, I thought I'll organize a picnic with a bus full of all characters that have been created and carved by these six predecessors of chapters, and put it in a ditch so that they all die, and close the story there. I was prompted several times that let me create all the, but then all the characters are rich people. You see them here also, some of them. Very rich characters. I couldn't have put them in a bus and really caused an accident and killed them. These 55 people were on my bus. The ship was sailing in the sea where we were to go for a manthan. We were going to find a leader, the Anant Shai, who was never found in manthan. What we found were gems, jewels, cows, and whatever, Kamadhenu, Kalpa Vriksha, and Lakshmi also, but not Vishnu. We did not find the leader. I mean, I would like to simulate that, and very rightly, very confidently, that we did not find it. So your churn has to continue. Our churn will have to continue. Because will we find the Anadi Anant in the leader? I think perhaps you get the simulation that I'm trying to suggest. Your churn must continue. Leadership is something which at the turn of the millennium, even the Davos people started thinking, what are the challenging issues for the coming millennium? And they said, maybe leadership is one critical issue where there is a huge dearth and shortage of leaders. It the nations will have to think of, the entrepreneurs will have to think of, the countries will have to think of, the politicians will have to think of how to create a development. I think the churn must continue. I would like to thank you, all of you, friends and family, and the honorable guests here for being and supporting us, and my dear partners, Ajay and I'm glad I saw you also in the bus, so be happy that you are here. Thank you very much and God bless you. Wish you all the best. I really admire and enjoyed working with two of you, really. Thank you very much. Thank you.
It's an honor to have Dr. Atreya as chief guest for this launch ceremony today. Ladies and gentlemen, requesting Padma Bhushan Dr. Atreya to please honor us with his presidential address.
Ladies and gentlemen, we began with a good evening. The time is approaching to say almost good night. It's an occasion of great ananda, paramananda, that we are releasing a book which has taken a great deal of effort, participation of a number of people. And we've had several very good speeches, and we've learned about leadership. We began the function at 6:30. I would like to compliment you for your stamina, interest, jignasa, that you are staying here to listen to all of us. The hall was full at the start. About 25% of people have been leaving, understandably. It started around 7:45, because people always have families and other things, end of the week. So I'd like to make you an offer that you don't have to listen to another speech. I have no hang-up about being the chief guest, and it's not my need to make a speech. Therefore, if you would rather like to break for dinner, which was to be announced at 8:15, it is now 8:30, I'm quite happy to withdraw and join you at dinner. I have
more.
A reasonable appetite. So what is your choice?
Would
you like to continue,
you.
Or we rather
don't
make
you,
a dinner? I think the book has been talked about, the subject has been talked about, you had a lovely evening, I have enjoyed and benefited from it. And I think for a change, we dispense with the chief guest speech and still have a jolly good function.
No way.
You want to hear us, sir.
Then you have a speeches as soon as you want. You have to have a back bench as soon as
you want.
Well, I'll take a little less time than I had originally planned.
Thank you.
First of all, I'd like to join everybody else in congratulating the three authors, the various contributors, the BIMSTEC institution which has supported them. I had great pleasure reading the manuscript and writing the foreword, and when those of you who read it, you will find that I have highlighted the strengths of the book, comparing it with some other leadership books, and commending it to all students and practitioners of leadership. In this address, I'd like to talk not so much about the book, which has been covered very well, but talk about some very celebrated leaders of the world, of India, of Indian business, of global business, and see what we can learn from celebrated leaders. And I'm sure that a lot of it is reflected in the book in one way or the other. But it is possible that each of us may not know all these leaders who have participated in these. People in a particular industry will know, in the steel industry or in the oil industry and so on. The leaders I'm going to talk about are universally known. Therefore, it will register with each one of us here. And they are practicing the same art and science leadership that we have talked about. In leadership, there is a model of competencies, which is well known to HR professionals, but many of you here are not from the HR field. Every good leader needs four basic sets of attributes. They are together known as CASH, K-A-S-H, K for knowledge, A for attitudes, S for skills, and H for habits. But today, many of the young managers who come into companies already in the last 30 years, they've been coming with an MBA, majority of them, or at least with a B.Tech, M.Tech, B.Com, M.Com, in some cases CA kind of qualifications, so the knowledge component is taken care of. What we need to focus in leadership development are the two more difficult areas, and there one is relatively even more difficult. The two areas that need attention are attitudes and skills.
And between the two, it is my experience over the last 50 years dealing with leaders in India and around the world. For example, I was a HR mentor for Siemens for the Asia Pacific region, 16 countries, various cultures, various foreign investments and so on. So between these two, what we found more difficult were attitudes and the values behind the attitudes. People can learn skills, decision making, implementation, project management, monitoring, review, appraisal, these can be learned. But the mindset, the attitude, the soul, the atma, the dil, the buddhi that goes with it is more difficult. And I'd like to here highlight the value leaders first and come to skill leaders later. In value leadership, recently in a conference, I was talking about what are the three great challenges to humanity in the 21st century. And to meet those challenges, what kind of leadership we need. And in my analysis, the three biggest challenges facing entire humanity in the 21st century are, first of all, climate change, the way the temperatures are rising, the global, for example, recently in Canada, a river disappeared in 4 days, you might have read about it. It is like a repeat of Saraswati civilization, which disappeared in India a few years ago, and more such disasters can happen. We already have a new category of refugees called climate refugees, who are leaving their homes because they're threatened by water, heat, wildlife, and so on. The first challenge, therefore, is climate change. The second is inequality, rising inequality. Marx is again becoming relevant. And 2 years ago, there was a book by a French economist, Thomas Piketty. Some of you may have read reviews of it. Capital in the 21st century. We thought that with Gorbachev and the perestroika, the dissolution of the Soviet Union, capitalism as a system was established, and socialism, communism will not come back again. But now there is talk about revolutions, what is happening in many parts of the world, regions wanting autonomy, people wanting to opt out of unions, and the election of Donald Trump is partly the result of increasing inequality in the United States, the 1%, 99% gap that is developing. And some economists like Paul Krugman talk about 0.1% and 99.9%. And India also, this is likely to rise. And the third is terrorism. In my view, terrorism is not the number one challenge, although it gets lots of headlines. But religious conflict, terrorism, is another challenge. And if you look at leaders who can help us to deal with these kinds of issues, they need to follow the models which have been of great success in the 21st, 20th and 19th centuries. And I think in all the debates about climate change, terrorism, inequality, the one leader that keeps coming up in all global conferences is Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi is found more relevant to people around the world than we in India. We tend to forget him. But all these issues, inequality, his point about the world has enough for everyone's need, but not for anyone's greed. Sharing wealth, himself giving away his possessions. And he has been followed by two other great leaders from whom we can learn. Martin Luther King in the US, who fought the civil rights battle for the blacks without violence, and succeeded a great deal more than Naxal. Recently, the Outlook magazine has brought out a special issue of Silver Jubilee of the Naxal Revolution. 50th year of Naxal Revolution. I came to Calcutta in 67 October. Naxal Bari had broken out in February 1967. I lived through the Naxal period in Calcutta the next 6 years. Gharaos, various kinds of Solvena, Hovena, shutdowns of various kinds. And that movement has fizzled out. So violence is not the way. What is in Pekasina's back of his jersey is very valid. The highest bravery is non-violence. And after Martin Luther King, the other leader who is globally remembered, for whose funerals all world leaders came, is Nelson Mandela. Nelson Mandela has solved one of the greatest problems of human civilization. how two races can come together without a bloodbath. The alternative would have been for the whites in South Africa to have been butchered by the blacks, and it is Mandela who preserved the amity and the unity of those people. Those are the kinds of leaders we need. And if we look at the Indian experience, we have had a great deal of discussion on Jawaharlal Nehru, great leader, no question. But there are two other leaders who have not got their due, who I would like to highlight for your attention today. Subhash Bose. If you look for a Nishkama Karma leader, selfless, daring, going to Japan, Germany, in a submarine, in those days, organizing the Indian National Army. Even today, when you hear the songs of the INA, that's India's unity. That's India's purpose. So Subhash Bose was not dreaming about becoming Prime Minister or any members of his dynasty becoming rulers of this country. He was only interested in fighting the British and Indian independence. The third leader we can look at, who is the non-violent mode but hugely effective, underrated, is Jayaprakash Narayan. I went to the UK as a visiting professor in 1973, and I was given a chair in Strathclyde at a very young age of 34. There was a 5-year tenure for the chair. My wife and I were about to come back in 1975 when emergency was declared. We read much more news about the Indian emergency in the British press and in the BBC than people got in India. It went underground. So we postponed our return to India, but in 1977, I was traveling in February when the successor Jayaprakash Narayan's moral crusade against the emergency, against corruption, resulted in the building of Janata Dal. At that time, there were great hopes. It was almost like a democratic revolution. The first real alternative to a single party Congress rule from 1947 to 1977. Janata Dal came to power. I gave notice to my Vice Chancellor 2 years ahead of time and came back to India at the end of my 3rd year at the Strathclyde Business School, 78 October. This Janata Dal broke up, that's a tragedy. India could have had a two-party system if what Jayaprakash Narayan achieved had been sustained, but the Janata philosophy is not dead, it is still alive. In 2019, the only credible alternative to Narendra Modi for India's leadership is Nitish Kumar of Janata Dal United, and I think the rest of the opposition, if they have sense enough to unite around him, there is a reasonable chance that a non-BJP secular government may come to power. This is a possibility. So the legacies that great leaders leave behind appear in danger, but they are so strong, the seeds are so powerful, that they keep coming back. So Gandhi is alive worldwide, Gandhi is relevant in India, the 2019 150th anniversary that we'll be celebrating him. Swachh Bharat is based on Mahatma Gandhi, the National Rural Employment Scheme is based on his name. Let me now come to vision and strategy based leadership. And in vision and strategy, not just the values which Gandhiji and others, Nehru was an outstanding leader. If you look at the transition from colonialism to democracy, India was the first example to the world of establishing a democracy based on a constitution and adult suffrage. In the midst of a lot of argument that how can illiterates vote, even today you hear about it in the dinner parties of the bourgeoisie in India, Nehru was very clear that every adult citizen of the country must have the voting power. And Nehru was strong on political vision and strategy, but unfortunately, he was not so strong on economic vision and strategy. And that is why the strategy, the policies had to be revised in 1991. Between 1950 and 1990, India grew at an average, as all of us know, of 3.5%. So the country lost 2 to 3% growth every year for the 50-year period, when South Korea, Malaysia, Indonesia, Vietnam, countries way behind us in education, were growing at that rate. Today we are trying to catch up. The second non-value-based but Machiavellian, Chanakya kind of leader, from whom people keep learning leadership lessons, is Churchill. And the thing about Churchill is that he was a very strong war leader. He was a very poor peacetime leader. So leaders have their particular strengths which we can draw on. And he was defeated right after the war. And in fact, he was a great enemy of Indian freedom. And books that have come out later about him show the darker side. So leaders are not perfect. They have strengths. They also have lots of weaknesses. And Churchill was one of the causes behind the Bengal famine. He was not bothered about Indian lives. If the war had gone longer, there would have been more famines in the country. He did not want Indian independence. He did not want one Pakistan. He wanted India broken up into 100 countries. So he was an imperialist. But on protecting Europe, Britain, against Hitler and the Nazi threat, and saving Christian civilization, he did a great job. He was a fantastic leader. Without America came late into the war. It was the British leadership and initiative, tenacity, which turned the tide in the Second World War. So from Nehru and Churchill, I would like to come to Narendra Modi. When Pritam Singh talked about Modi, he was talking about Rusi Modi. Many people thought in the audience that he looked up to Narendra Modi. Now, we may not all agree on all the philosophy of Narendra Modi. 2003 in Gujarat is still being discussed. But what is remarkable is that he won that election in 2014. And despite the little setback in Delhi and Bihar, he continues to win. The UP win was not anticipated by anybody in India, any party, even the BJP. And now journalists who have been highly critical of him are agreed on one thing, that he is a great communicator. He is a great organizer. He works very hard. Recently in one of the rallies, he joked with the audience, huge audience in UP, मैं पहला प्रधानमंत्री हूँ जिस जिनके पास ये पूछा जा रहा है आप प्रधानमंत्री तो बन गए हो इतना काम क्यों करते हो Why are you working so hard? He sleeps 4 hours a day, works 18 hours, so does Yogi Adityanath. Modi is now talking about a new vision of a new India 2022. He is not bothered about 2019, he is looking beyond that. What is that vision? He wants an India in which everybody is conscious of being an Indian first and any other identity later. Sabka vikas, sabka saath. So let us see if he delivers on it, if he sticks to it. He has a lot of other fringes in the party. So what he may achieve if he continues till 2022, very likely, economic inclusion is possible. All minorities, all parts of India, all castes of Hindu society would participate in the economy. Social inclusion is still a question mark. So we have to also watch our leaders, keep evaluating from below, and not become hero worshippers of any leader at any time. From my experience from Calcutta and later, interaction with Indian businesses, Marwari, Gujarati, Parsi, South Indian, Chetia, various businesses, if I were to pick out some examples of outstanding leadership from whom we can learn, on the top of the list would come G.D. Birla. In pre-independence days, the Congress political movement and Indian business had a very amicable relationship. It was in 1947 to 1890 that business and government in India had an adversarial relationship. Since 91, we have re-established a partnership with business. CII, FICCI, ASSOCHAM are all partners in the formulation of policy. And G.D. Birla has been followed by Aditya Birla, another great strategist who took his company global during the license permit Raj. And now Kumar Mangalam Birla, and we have Sony here, a representative of that group, doing very well, going great guns. It does not mean that every business succeeds or that all of them create the same kind of shareholder value, but overall the group strategy is clearly articulated. There is leadership development within for succession. Now, despite the various criticisms, we must admire the leadership of Dhirubhai Ambani to build such a huge enterprise during the license permit Raj. And if he broke rules, Swedish consultants with whom I met several times said that India needed people like him, only then it can grow in the license permit Raj. They called it growth of plants through asphalt, greenery through asphalt is what he felt, and now his sons are taking it forward, mega companies. The very fact that Jio can come in and shake up the telecom industry shows the huge power of investment. In the public sector, it has been my pleasure to work with several great leaders. Out of them, if I were to pick one, it is V. Krishnamurthy. His record is unmatched. He not only built BHEL, which is the first company, the first large electric power manufacturing company in the country, but he built two very different kind of enterprises. Maruti, which is in consumer durable, cars for the first time, and it was after Maruti came, the 800, that the whole idea of the automobile in India changed. We were stuck with 20,000 cars per annum of Ambassador and Fiat. And some of you are here too young to remember that period. And people waited 7-10 years to get a car. And you had to know an IAS officer or a minister to even get on the list, waiting list for those cars. Now you look at the number of vehicles that are available. Maruti has become larger than Suzuki of Japan, its parent company. Maruti will be the biggest exporter of cars for Suzuki. They are closing down manufacturing in Japan and transferring to India. It's an outstanding example of Make in India campaign that the government wants. I had the privilege of writing the foreword for his book also. So when Mr. Sinha came, I had no difficulty in agreeing that leadership theme is very important. And internationally well-known corporate leader who has also come to India and is well known here is Jack Welch of GE. But his successor, Jeff Immelt, is as good a leader, in some respects maybe even more sensible. And these two together help us understand one factor about leadership, that charisma is useful, but it's also dangerous. Jack Welch has charisma. He could do some wrong things as well. You need a professional leader who may lack charisma, but is very systematic, methodical, value-based, predictable, and will build his succession from within the organization. I think it will be useful to acknowledge two outstanding social leaders in the country, non-political, but economy-related social leaders. One is Kurian. His mission of building the Dairy Development Board, Amul now, the only consumer brand which stands up out against 9 multinational consumer brands, the legacy is continuing. He had his problems. He had difficulty leaving the organization. He fought with his successor. So leaders have their weaknesses. But what he has built, the model, the idea of cooperative, the producer getting a fair share of the revenue, a knock at the inequality problem, creating employment at the source, therefore avoiding revolutions and various kinds of discontinuities. And more recently, Sridharan, who is now leading, every Indian metro is now having a metro. Delhi began with his metro, but his example, despite his bypass surgery, 80 plus, he is available as a leader to motivate, and many of his chelas from Delhi Metro are running the other metros elsewhere in the country. So I talked about value-based leadership, vision and strategy-based leadership. Let me now come to the third major area where we need leadership in the country, is organization development and human resource development, people. So I talked about business context. Now the OD, HRD area, I think the book recognizes this, J.R.D. Tata would be among the stalwarts. He was not as astute a businessman as G.D. Birla, but in terms of people management and development, encouraging talent, he was a great leader. And under him grew other giants. This is a mark of a great leader, that he doesn't have mediocre people under him, but the people, each one of them is outstanding, could be as good as him, could succeed him as the group head, if the Parsi constraint was not there. Among those, some of you may have met, for a long time, Telco was known as the mother company in the automobile industry. Tisco was known as the mother company in the steel industry, from where a lot of steel executives came. Later on, BHEL became the mother company in the power sector. IOC was a mother company in the oil segment. JRD and his top stalwarts, Murgaonkar, Darbari Set, F.C. Kohli, who is recognized now as the father of the Indian IT industry. But I would not include the C. Modi on that list for the same reason that Vikram Singh. Rishi Modi was a great people leader in Tata Steel, unions, workers, but he was not a disciplined leader. He rebelled against the group chairman. He even cited, there were reports that he would be inciting union agitation against the Ratan Tata leadership. So Ratan Tata had to take a firm stand at some point of time. And I think it is a mark of a good leader that you can not only be empowering and so on, but where necessary, strike. And Pritam Singh's several quotations, Sanskrit quotations, inspire me to at least make one. Paritranaya sadhunam, vinashaya dushkritam. The leader, many Indian leaders have this weakness. They are soft leaders. They encourage people when they perform, but they are not able to chop dead wood. One leader who has steeled himself to do it, Azim Premji, you might have read reports that after appraisals, he has let 500 people go. At one go. He has also donated 25,000 crores for education, the greatest act of philanthropy of any Indian business. Among the banks, the service sector, non-manufacturing sector, I had the privilege of interacting with R.K. Talwar of State Bank of India, the first non-white chairman of the State Bank of India. Age of 46, he became chairman. Ishwar Dayal, S.K. Bhattacharya from IIM Ahmedabad, myself, Nitish Day from IIM Calcutta, we were the consultants. They were working on the budgetary systems and structure. We were working on the behavioral aspects of leadership, conflict resolution, change management, values. And out of Talwar's leadership grew Wagul, who set up ICICI, which has grown a great deal. And it is the organization with the largest number of female executives. If you look for gender justice, it is ICICI. And Wagul's chair, Kamath, is now chair of the Asian Bank of Development, with China, India, several companies. That's the kind of pipeline. About ITC, the more charismatic leader, Ajit Thakser, is well known, but the person who really built organization development in HRD and ITC, which provided the human capital for all the diversifications that have taken place later, ITC has achieved something remarkable globally. Very few companies are successful in making 50% diversification. Their original core business comes down to 50% of turnover and profit, and new businesses are raised up to 50%. The chairman who did this was Jagdish Sapru. He was not an aggressive, dominant chairman. He was replacing a strong earlier chairman, Ajit Thakser. But during Sapru's time, people like Rajan Brijnath, Zahid Ganji, the Manu Basu, the MDG, Management Development Group of ITC, built the talent, and it became one of the benchmarks for various OD and HRD process in the country. I was very pleasantly surprised in 1976 to be called to meet D.V. Kapoor in his office. D.V. Kapoor was earlier in BHL. He was the first chairman, in my experience, who wanted my help, not in strategy, not in vision, not in organization structure. He wanted my help in building management systems and processes in India. Generally in India, we have a very high level of indiscipline. You will see that no queue is trained in India, either in a buffet, dinner, or at the airport, or in a bank. Always it's straight up. People are trying to. So he said, Dr. Atreya, I am very aware. I am having now, Mrs. Gandhi wants me to build huge power projects. In power project, to do it within 36 months, you need discipline, you need system, time frames, milestones, and I therefore want to create an organization which is initially based on very sound management systems and processes. And ATPC has succeeded today in replacing the SEB, State Electricity Boards, as a major power supplier, mainly because of the foundation of management systems that Desh Kapoor began. The second industry where many leaders like Nandan Nilekani, for example, outstanding leader, who have succeeded is IT. And what they have created for the first time is a global delivery system model. To have people working in India and have their non-manufactured services delivered worldwide requires a great deal of discipline, systems and processes. And Narayana Murthy was the first IT leader who talked about, we want processes which are person independent. In the typical Indian organization, every man will come and change the process the way he likes. And every promoted officer will say that, what was my boss doing in the previous incumbent? I have inherited a chaos here. I have to sort it out and he will make all kinds of changes. Now, in an organized company, you cannot make a system change without first putting up a request, having it approved. So when India went into liberalization, for the first time we went into quality systems, ISO 9000, now very well known, very widely spread. Even today, we are finding difficulty in the Indian pharma industry, where factory after factory is being closing down because of the FDA inspections, and the share prices are falling along with them. And we have to regain the confidence of the American regulator. One other leader who was strong on systems, not so much on banking, financial strategies, Deepak Parekh in HDFC. It was the first housing finance company which had a strategy of branch banking around the country. Same kind of logo, same systems. Cut down the lead time from between application and dispensing the loan, and they were a pre-runner of today's e-retail industry. I'd like to conclude with one last point, that what we now need to see in Indian organizations is not a current leadership, which is necessary, chairman or director, senior management. In the long run, whether India will catch up, even part of the way, China is today 5 times the size of the Indian. This gives them enormous economic and military power. There's no way in which we can fight Arunachal Pradesh if they decide to invade. We can try and go to the United Nations and build alliances and so on. But if we were to meet that kind of a competition, we need a leadership pipeline. Every company needs to look at where are our leaders for the next 30 years, begin to identify the talent, stream them, and have at every level options that are available. Now, the leadership pipeline idea first caught on in the PSUs because they are not driven only by cost and profits. And Tauro at Indian Oil Corporation was one of my first experiences where he said, Dr. Atria, please help us. We want to invest in the development of all our executives and managers, even if we cannot utilize all of them. Some of them may go to other oil companies. Some of them may go to other industries. Some of them may go to the private oil sector as and when it comes up. But we want to develop as much talent as we can, that I can afford it. So it was an ITC that we built career path models for every senior position. And every engineer officer was systematically rotated depending on his potential, depending on the kind of job for which he was being groomed in the future. And this is now becoming more widespread practice. And I see now in groups like Aditya Birla, Mahindra, Bharat Forge, TTK Group, the Harishchandra Singhania Group, many of them, career planning and succession planning is receiving a lot of attention. But still, we have one huge gap. Good corporate governance requires that we have a great deal better succession planning for board membership. At the moment, both for full-time directors as well as independent directors, who in recent events it has been asked, are directors capable of challenging the chairman, raising questions? Only then a value system, various kinds of infringements can be discussed in the board, and we have still not reached that level of director material which needs to be groomed and developed, which can stand up to either an owner leader or an appointed leader, and we may have more and more expected leaders also in some of our companies. So So I think we have progressed a great deal from where we were in 1967 when I came back to IIM Calcutta, and again in 1978 when I came back to the post-emergency India. But in terms of international benchmarking and with China in particular, we have a long way to go. And books like this, documenting Indian experience, 12 workshops, 56 individual leaders writing their experience, the three authors putting it together. This will spark, I think, more thinking and review, reminiscencing, sharing experiences. So I hope this book will start a trend where there may be more imitators. That will be good for the country. More people, more experiences, richer sharing. We may also have to have differentiated leadership, different industries, different regions of the country, cultural differences, just like multinationals have to adjust to intercultural management practices. So once again, I commend the authors, I commend BIMSTEC, the publisher, and all of you for staying so late and listening to me. It is 9 o'clock. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
As a token of our gratitude to our esteemed guests, may I now request Dr. Anupam Verma, Deputy Director and Dean Academics at BIMTEC, to please join our Director, Dr. Chaturvedi, to felicitate our guests.
For giving us the opportunity to publish this book. And sir, thank you for bringing up, giving this idea of the cover, which has come out so well. And I hope, sir, we get an opportunity to work with you in future also. Thank you so much.
This brings us to the end of this book launch ceremony today. I now take the privilege of inviting all the dignitaries on the dais, guests, and all colleagues to join us for dinner. Mr. P. Dwarkanath, you are most welcome. I see a bouquet in your hands.
I just want to give it to my friend, Mr. Sinha.
I'll focus to get a doctorate.